Director Andrei Tarkovsky's fondness of nature led to the practical question, how do you fabricate wind for cinema? How does wind become an image? Tarkovsky relied on motorized aerial power. The gusts were created by a helicopter well placed for this artificial effect that blows across the crop field. Around the same period, countless aerial operations redesigned landscapes, cities, and fields. Mostly these were military operations. Some were agricultural. In some cases, the two were and remain indistinguishable. Fabricating wind is close to what cinema does anyway, creating movement across vast surfaces. Airborne, the surface is a field of operations. Surveying, bombing, hydrating, seeding, replanting, calculating, quantifying. The military history of the aerial view transforms also into guerrilla farming. What is perceived as planetary surface is transformed into synthetic surfaces with chemistry, captured as synthetic landscapes, as data. Logistics of perception is also logistics of synthesis. Many of the images in this video are from companies promoting their seed bombing services. Some are more speculative. The persistence of military metaphors is obvious, yet peculiar. Isn't there a discrepancy between the rapidity of destruction and the slowness of growth? Seed pods hit the ground. They replant and restore vegetal surfaces. We are shown airplanes and drones. They are better for accessing difficult sites, we are told. They can cover much larger areas than by foot. The scenes we have combined, juxtaposed, and rearranged show the air, the ground, seeds, and images. They show the air from the ground from the air, the plants as images, and images as they define the ground.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of Digital Dish, organized by Ludmila and Prijeka Tol. I'm very pleased to introduce today's guest, well-known media theorist and researcher, Jussi Parikka. Jussi, welcome.
Thank you.
Jussi Parikka is a professor of technological culture and aesthetics at Winchester School of Art and starting January 2022, a professor of digital aesthetics at Aarhus University in Denmark. He's a member of academia and Europea and a visiting professor at FAMU, the Academy of Performing Arts in Prague, where he leads the project Operational Images and Visual Culture. His published books include Insect Media, Digital Contagions, A Genealogy of Media, and What is Media Archaeology. Recently, he co-edited Photography of the Scale, and he's also co-author of the lab book Situated Practices in Media Studies. The title of today's presentation and lecture is on vegetal surfaces and scale of images. The lecture will discuss Jussi's work in progress research on vegetal images in collaboration with Abelardo Gil-Fournier, and the talk draws on their recent audiovisual essay Seed Image Ground. We have already seen a few clips of the video, and the whole video will be streamed at the end, after the discussion, which will follow the lecture. So, Jussi, once again, welcome. Great to have you here. And please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It really is a pleasure to be here with you, in dialogue with you, Robert. And thank you to Maya and the whole Ludmila team as well, and all the organizers. It's really a pleasure. It would be even better to be, you know, doing this dialogue, as you know, in same space, but this will do as well. You already mentioned some of the key things indeed. already mentioned that I'll be talking about this work in progress with Abelardo. I just finished, or I'm about to finish, this book called Operational Images, which is not what I'm going to specifically talk about, but I wanted to mention, you know, I mean, it's, everybody's relieved when they finish a big project that I'm almost finished with this, which outlines some aspects of this notion of operational image that Harun Farocki developed some 20 years ago approximately, and which has then lived in different contexts of technological imaging, like context of AI and machine vision and artistic discourses and such. But the book itself sort of offers one outline of what are the possible forces of that concept beyond what Farocki said or what Hito Steil said or what Trevor Paglen said. So, but that's slightly separate, but it's part of this bundle of topics that I've been working on, and today's talk is part of that bundle as well. And I want to give, and I'm going to mention many times, a hat tip to Abelardo Gil-Fournier, who's a Madrid-based artist, who also works with me as part of this bigger project, which coincidentally is called Operational Images, in Prague at FAMU. As part of other team members as well. And under that, my work on operational images, this topic today, but also many other colleagues' topics, we sort of try to investigate these transformations of not only photographic culture indeed, but broader image cultures, including questions of environmental imaging as well. And I won't go on about the actual operational images, the project that funded by Czech Science Foundation. It's hovering there at the background of my talk in a way as a reference point. But our project is the main focus today. And it's this peculiar kind of an entry point to images. We call it, well, we sort of refer to vegetal images and vegetal surfaces that I hope to explain a bit more in this short talk. I'll talk max, I think, 30 minutes, and then the video that you saw a bit of already, and you'll see at the end more. Just to mention again, Abelardo has worked a lot already on this topic in his own artistic work. He's engaged with these various material aspects of media ecology, but ecology in quite concrete sense, about multiple scales of different vegetal surfaces. So a lot of this also is a combination of our interests. So I'm speaking again on both, you know, in a way, behalf of both. And Abelardo has worked both in relation to these, some of these works, and you'll find these online, these installation works and others. He's worked on practice-based, but also a bit theoretically and more theoretically also in our work, on these cultural techniques that map the links between these growing forms of plant and agricultural life, and how these come to redefine particular questions of media and mediation as well, which is pretty much one way of summarizing my interest at the moment as well, of this exchange between vegetal and mediatic, not just for the sake of that, it's another kind of interesting neologism to start talking about media plants, plant media, whatever, but actually for particular reasons that I hope to outline a bit more in detail. There's a growing amount of work already on farms and farm media, and of course in philosophical and aesthetic context and visual culture research on plants and soil, whereas we want to build our research project in a way, I mean, we want to build this the research project that is going to culminate in a book on the idea of images as surfaces, especially these particular kinds of living surfaces that are governed as images. So the point is specific to a particular regime of understanding management of surfaces. That is a question not specific to one industry only, or area of governance, but shifts across scales, both in our investigation and also today. A key part of this will be about scales. So the bigger project, Vegetal Images, examines how the surface of the Earth has approximately over the last two centuries become known and perceived as an environment of images. In other words, the understanding of the planet made up of surfaces of different types is linked to material production and distribution of synthetic surfaces of a distinct kind. We often call them images. These can be formed on the visual light spectra. They can be formed outside it, radiating outside the visible light spectra, or as circulating as paper maps, other kinds of objects and material things, perhaps elaborated as electronic signal systems and data platforms. And intersections of light, data, and surfaces become really central to our interest and what we argue are material epistemic drivers for a particular way of understanding, and this is a term that often circulates in contemporary discourse, planetarity. So surfaces as a way, insights to planetarity, and hence already multi-scalar. More concretely, the broad argument builds on the history of observation of vegetal phenomena through the use of visual media, such as photography, early moving images, as well as recently digital technologies employing, for instance, massive data sets of remote sensing. Historical examples beyond contemporary technologies imply also the broader argument about ecological aesthetics and media theory. So that by focusing on the surface of the image in order to understand the growth and movements of the surface of the Earth, we look at images so that we understand what the Earth is about, right, in very simple terms. We demonstrate how this link is both historically grounded and fruitful as a speculative proposal about the aesthetic and the scientific operations of images. So one could say, for example, that this kind of infrastructure of observation as the Landsat satellite system since 1972 is one core part of this history. The Landsat system is governed by NASA and the US Geological Survey and can be deciphered as one key surface technology. Okay, and this is the sort of a conjunction we are trying to make, these particular kinds of aerial views, including satellite orbital views as surface technologies, because they produce images of surfaces and they produce surfaces as ways of understanding Earth processes. So this is what we often look at, both from contemporary journalism to other sorts of, let's say, media of representations, a term that I don't often use, but, you know, images of patterns of change, of Earth observation, climate change, agriculture, forests, forest cover, coastal lines, wildlife, all kinds of observation events. In the book, we're not after one particular contemporary technology like satellites, but even if it's crucial, of course, for contemporary understanding of the pattern of Earth as a surface, and which is really interesting in its own right. We could talk about multiple kinds of images and whether they're images even. I'm coming as a very, in a very amateurish way to this, but I'm sort of interested in questions of remote sensing, for instance, the ways in which different sort of spectral indexes, normalized difference vegetation index or NDVI, becomes the background or the sort of infrastructure of imaging of the Earth as well. But also we look at many multiple kinds of observation events and images of vegetal matter, relating to photosynthesis, plant physiology since state, 19th century mostly, 21st century machine vision, as mentioned, AI techniques, and much more. And there's multiple angles. I won't mention more because it would just, be too much to try to summarize everything in one go. Instead, I'll mention what I'll talk about today, and I'll do a very short talk about themes that are also articulated in the video. I'll talk through topics related to seed image ground that you saw a tiny bit of. The video is not to be seen. It's not meant as an illustration of theoretical arguments. It's not that we do theory and then we do a video about how what we think, but it's a matter of trying to see of what are images also as methodological forms of understanding scales of surfaces. These key themes that are part of research and the video as well. Surfaces, vegetal growth, mediation, transformations of what we mean by images and seeing. All these are entangled in multiple ways. So we try to present a series of surfaces and scales that appear in and through these images. We also articulate the video essay as a practice of surfaces and plants and images. Central motive is to ask, what do images of growth and movement look like? How do these images operate in this split screen space? Ideally, a double projection, practice that builds, of course, also on Harun Farocki's work, among many others. Not just operational images, but also the term soft montage that I'll briefly mention at the end. And in a way, this way, the video is a methodological exercise that helps to articulate a problem space, a term that I use from Celia Lurie, who's a social scientist, but the work is really resonating with a lot of problems, or let's say practices in aesthetic and let's say this media theoretical context as well. A problem space where problems and methods and concepts are dynamically re-articulated and where their space, the space of their composition, is not only a stable container where we identify a thing that we want to investigate, but it's fabricated in the making of. So in her words, a problem is not given, but emerges within and out with a myriad sequence of actions or methods that transforms the problem space. So we want to sort of ask, by way of looking at video, movement, images, sequences, we want to ask, can this sequence that Lurie talks about, can it also be a sequence of images? A really simple question, but itself, I believe, methodologically really interesting when you put it next to archival practices and theoretical practices. A lot of themes that perhaps are also being discussed in different forms in the talk series as well. What is implied is that this problem space, and here the metaphorical use of problem space and the concrete spaces and landscapes I'm talking about, this become somehow entangled. And this fabrication of surfaces that might concern landscapes and design and construction and agriculture becomes a question of images about surfaces. And by way of also organizing images like we do in the video, we try to build up an argument, if that makes sense. So that's pretty much the sort of introduction spiel, the sort of a like layout that I'm really after as well. And I have two sections that I'll sort of talk through. This one is mostly about talking through some themes about vegetal images and a bit about the video. And then pending on time, I'll continue a tiny bit about the soft montage as a particular kind of a trope that has to do with very specific questions of montage. But also it becomes a sort of a like one theoretical way of understanding the work of concepts and themes as well. And then we'll have time for a dialogue with Robert and for audience questions as well at the end. So, Seed Image Ground, the video was commissioned by Photo Museum Winterthur in 2020 for this series called Strike/Situations. Harun Farocki's cinematic installation works addressing operational images were implied in their commissioning text, which focused on, I quote their words, for the Museum Winterthur, the increasing entanglement of civil and military technology, asking, and I quote again, what happens when photographic media are deployed operatively, for the purposes of tracking and tracing, identifying and monitoring individuals, or controlling machines engaged in surveillance and military activities. It's a sort of a line that they were producing for the curatorial program that rings and resonates across multiple concerns of contemporary debates about surveillance beyond in and beyond military. Our aim, however, was to divert from the strictest sense of strike and to consider the diversion as part of this, well, the fact that, you know, legacy of aerial images mostly often is read as in relation to military operations and military surveys and targeting, to we were wanting to divert into slightly different parallel uses, and hence this topic of plant growth and planetary surfaces. In a way, this alternative emphasis that we really wanted to bring out, despite this narrative theme of seed bombing, right, that I'll briefly mention soon, this alternative theme comes to the fore in different contexts after the commissioning program as well. Different curatorial contexts where the video is now shown. So earlier this year, this was installed in Shenzhen in China in the Vibrating Cloud exhibition on atmospheres, air, and other projects, other contexts of elemental media. At the moment, I believe it's still on. It's on in St. Petersburg in Russia at the Tokuchaev Soil Museum in the exhibition on grounding. So you see that it's sort of a like, it's already been re-articulated in different ways in curatorial contexts. It works by way of found footage from online archives to YouTube, from commercial and seed bombing adverts to precision farming, historical footage of plant physiology, time-lapse images, data visualization as well. This footage assembles a range of surfaces that were tied together with a rhetorical fabrication of images as almost literally about fabrication of surfaces and fabrication of movement as fabrication of growth. In other words, it responds to Harun Farocki's note on the method of the double, also double projection. In his own reflection on machine vision and operational images, hence this quote, "I was struck by the horizontal connection of meaning, the connection between productive force and destructive force." Although what we want to argue is that obviously, and also probably Farocki as well, exactly that it's not a clear cut between the two at all, but considering the amount of weaponization of so-called ecological operations, ecological forces, whether this relates to agriculture or herbicides, but also the increasing and growing theme of right-wing climate consciousness and certain forms of eco-fascism, this become an interesting way of moving on to particular sort of a like everyday military regimes having to do with ecological problems that probably will be an increasingly central theme on a broader geopolitical level as well. In this video on Seed Image Ground, the sound design by Maria Andueza Olmedo takes over the scene even before the images appear. While their rhythm across the split screen that is split across split screen space is the central rhythmic element, the sound has its own narrative and non-narrative qualities. The remediation of the mechanical airlift of the helicopter rotors sets the backdrop of the cinematic 1970s. The whirling trope familiar from Apocalypse Now 79 is replaced into this other 70s cinematic maneuver that we find in Andrei Tarkovsky's Mirror, where the mystical wind that blows across the crop fields is created by a helicopter carefully placed behind the camera. This sound speaks to the periodization of a media archaeological combination of cinema and war, echoing Paul Virilio here, which is in this pace of the opening moments, quickly though replaced with the whirling rotation of the seedlings. Plants instead of bombs, one could think. But this is less an endorsement of hippies than one related to a different set of transformation of surfaces. In other words, if in certain modernist and architectural discourses, bombing and military aesthetics in general was seen as one form of redesigning cities in a very grim, cynical tone, this would then just point to the other aspect of refashioning landscapes by way of growing, by way of growing something in them. Again, you can see that there's a whole undercurrent in my talk as well in the project about particular forms of management of growth. Now we talk about carbon capture mechanisms by way of planting forests. So you can see that there's multiple scales to the issue beyond agriculture, food agriculture as such, right? So these images in our video, they produce a disjunction between operations of war and operations of growth. Hence the opening question of the voiceover, how do you fabricate wind? How do you fabricate wind? It's not about a poetic metaphysics, but one of specific situations of cultural techniques of environmental management. Not necessarily landscape design in the restricted sense of what we mean by landscape design, but closer to themes identified also by Keller Easterling in her idea of medium design. To design in relation to already existing spatial and material dispositions or affordances, to pick up on environments, concrete ecologies as already actively full of events and dynamics. So more than a question of how do you fabricate wind, it's an expression of a problem space. It even composes a problem space in the methodological arrangement of images across and on surfaces. I'm just checking where I am. Okay. So the video picks up on seed bombing as a motif that relates to specific techniques of plant growth and seeding, including in some cases it's been suggested in relation to reforesting. Seed bombing as such is not necessarily the most interesting techniques when it comes to large-scale reformatting of surfaces and landscapes. But it's a narrative thread, and it fits the bill in terms of this particular commission. Traditionally, seed bombing has been talked about in different scales. It's often talked about as a DIY technique of seeding derelict or hard-to-reach lands. But it also features in this interesting sort of a partly real, partly speculative histories of large-scale, for instance, reforestation. There's a background military history to seed bombing as well, as it emerges from the former RAF pilot Jack Walters's proposals. And already 20 years ago, it was developed, at least attempted to be developed as a commercial idea by Aerial Forestation Incorporated, which premised the idea's large-scale viability on, I quote, equipment installed in the huge C-120 transport aircraft used by military for traditionally laying carpets of landmines across combat zones, but now adapted to deposit trees in remote areas, including parts of Scotland. So anyway, we're not really trying to articulate anything new about seed bombing, but what's interesting is the relation between aerial power, aerial movement and military logistics as it's related to environmental techniques. The idea of a superiority of an aerial view has been outlined quite often in terms of what it means by way of particular perspectives and particular forms of survey and power. And there's wonderful work also on historical forms of aerial imaging. I've often in this longer talk of longer version of this talk and others, I refer to, among many others, by Karen Kaplan, also to Paul Sandamour's work who argues in his take on aerial imaging during First World War that it's basically a complex set of arrangements, ways of seeing as ways of knowing as well, this whole bundle of operations that enable to sustain this particular view of surfaces, landscape surfaces as images. And his work, he talks about applied modernism by way of military surveys as well, and these questions of photomosaic surfaces that are constructed from aerial photography and other forms of observation as well, and that then fed into civilian techniques after First World War as well, including urban planning, city planning, entrepreneurship, and many other kinds of contexts like mentioned here as well. This is just to kind of mention that this is a way for us to move from the idea of we're looking at only at images to images as composite surfaces that they composed from different data sets and data sources. And it's not merely specific to contemporary forms of Google Earth or other forms of satellite imaging and digital platforms, but it has this 100 years, at least 100 years of history. And this is why we're interested in these questions of how this understanding feeds into our case that has to do with vegetal surfaces. So we're not really after saying anything new about military imaging, but we want to sort of look at what it means for a particular question of these kinds of green landscapes as well. So three themes, at least, that are central to our interests. Plant growth becomes modeled as an image in laboratory practices often, 19th century, but also later as well. Growth and transformation has already early on in time-lapse images, its cinematic time-lapse and later on contemporary data platforms is often expressed as time-lapse images as well. And that these link up to a question of territorial management, management of territories as one that really centrally concerns what sort of images are produced and how those images become more than just representational images, how they have a particular interfacial quality, a quality of intervention built into them as well. And hence these questions of growth and management and images and data really bundle up into very interesting, crucial questions that have a contemporary relevance, but also have a history as well. We could talk longer about the particular questions that we're interested in with Abelardo about certain laboratory practices of plant physiology in 19th century. But broadly speaking, as a very broad summary, and we might return to this in the Q&A as well, plants are for us an interesting entry point, not just to the idea that, okay, we're dealing with plants as such, but also as an entry point to histories of media and logistics and visuality. And this, all of this is really central to a lot of post-human, critical post-human media theory, but it also pops up, of course, in history of sciences as well, from questions of botany, but also to history of science of images as well. Images and drawing and the epistemic values of truth to nature were central parts of 18th century botany and botanic drawing. The crucial work here has been, for us at least, Lorraine Daston and Peter Gallison's work. But also there would be much to be said about material cultures of infrastructure of images, including gardens, greenhouses, scientific expeditions, colonial ships, and transport of plant specimens and seeds. And the ways in which this links up in different moments of a history of history of science of plants, to put it like that, in different ways. So for instance, we're interested in this, as mentioned, 200-300 years of a roadmap of vegetal media that really moves on from early forms of mapping what is photochemistry, what is photosynthesis, to questions of plant physiology, and then the questions of how, for instance, questions of planetarity are being articulated in this context, and how that is the sort of the longer media history or media archaeology of contemporary discussions about planetarity as well. And again, I want to hat tip to goes to many others who are investigating questions of vegetal media at the same time. One of the really interesting ones is Robert Pietruszko, who also uses the term vegetal media in his work. So a hat tip there, or the parallel work. So what we're trying to argue is this, that experimental practices with technical media in the late 19th century form a particular phase of ecology of plant images. While photography of and by plants at the late 19th and early 20th century had already been discussed recently in scholarship, we want to point out how the experimental practices with vegetal surfaces are instrumental for a sense of planetary scale as well. And we're not dealing anymore only with visual images, despite the fact that I'm sort of attached to this term constantly as well, but as a distribution of matter and energy, and how this becomes re-articulated in different processes of air and chemistry as well. There would be a history of photography for this as well, from Fox Talbot's Cascade of Spruce Needles to microphotography, including scientific practices, to Harold Wager's perception of light in plants. But there's also this history of really looking at sort of a like chemical processes of photosynthesis as part of this broader chemical transformation of planetary surface. And again, you can see that I'm already hinting at these multiple forms of chemical transformations that are at the center of contemporary climate change as well. You know, photosynthesis and multiple other processes related then to, of course, fabrication of an artificial atmosphere due to industrialization. Despite the fact that our topic seems to be very, very specific. So we work a lot with these science studies inspired methods, but we also want to build this into an argument about images as well. You'll see at the end of this talk, you'll see the whole video, and you'll see that we sort of are condensing not really a history, but these scenes of different types of images into the 9-10 minute film or video, where we end up with questions of sort of alike, hinting at questions of data visualization and the broader data regimes, hence also machine vision that becomes a central technique for these kinds of ecologies as well. But this is also the reason why I want to sort of alike very briefly, because I'm sort of going way too long about many things. I'll jump into the last sort of section of the talk before I hand it over back to Robert and a discussion as well. And this third section is much longer than I am going to talk. I'm going to just give a really short summary of this last section in the interest of time. But I just want to point out and sort of return after discussing this sort of a more history of science and media context, I want to return to the question of images as central part of what we saw and what we will see as well. As mentioned, the images in the video are found images, and deliberately the video essay doesn't include any sequence that was filmed by us. They're sourced from multiple uses, as I mentioned. They are removed from their original arrangement. They are rearranged across the split screen space in context and referring to people who are researchers of Harun Farocki and cinema and other researchers like Christa Blümlinger. We refer to this idea that is centrally about organization of images, a management of images as a way of building the sense of what we mean by this ecological aesthetic. The split screen is a double articulation of images and landscapes, of images and territories. Blümlinger also continues how this idea is about multiple images and visual contexts that are created independently and how they collide in these split screen spaces. For us, this means really working with technical images, like from historical plant physiology and agricultural management, including soil maps and other specialist techniques of early data visualization. They become one reference point, but also we wanted to put in there very different kinds of images as well. Split screen as such would be, we could talk about that for a long time. Split screen is always more than two, as it has its own force as synthesis as well. Those interested in history of cinema as history of montage could say much more about this as well. From you know, avant-garde techniques like Dziga Vertov's fragmented visual space of superimposition of multiple kinds of images to different sorts of multi-screen projection formats and other besides projection, multi-screen formats, as central to Cold War military and media aesthetics as well. One could even speak of videographic cinema, as Jonathan Rosenkrantz has done in his recent book. And there's, of course, then the important work by Farocchi himself. So Farocchi's notes about soft montage, they come through, of course, in his own video work that is fundamentally so often about split screen works, not least iMachine series, which introduced the notion of operational images, but also beyond the iMachine series as well. There's really a lot to be said, and I'll kind of pull in a couple of quotes from Farocchi about what soft montage is. One would be this, to quote Farocchi, "A montage must hold together invisible forces, the things that would otherwise become muddled." For Farocchi, this is a way of organizing these histories of technologies of war, implying that montage is a method of articulating media archaeological continuities and discontinuities. For him, he's basically, and this is what Thomas Elsasser in Cinema Studies and many others have already pointed out, that Farocchi is a sort of a proto-media archaeologist or sort of a audiovisual media archaeologist because he's interested in these juxtapositions of military and civilian technologies that come through in those image series as well. And there's a sort of a, like an interesting way of understanding soft montage exactly as this compositional practice that is itself building, in Farocchi's understanding, a sort of historical argument about war technologies, which is why it holds this promise as a particular methodological way of understanding questions that are not just historical in the linear sense either. There's a wonderful quote about the sort of a double aspect of the split screen, a double aspect of the split screen, and double aspect of the sort of a composition and comparison that is going on. In Farocchi's words, there is succession in terms of the image series, as well as simultaneity in the double projection. The relationship of an image to the one that follows, as well as to the one beside it. A relationship to the preceding one, as well as the concurrent one. And this is an interesting sort of like chemical or atomic physical, you know, metaphor that follows. Three double bonds of a jumping back and forth between the six carbon atoms of a benzene ring. I envisage the same ambiguity in the relationship of an element in an image track to the one succeeding or accompanying it as well. So there's a lot there to be unpacked, and I won't go into it as well in terms of what it implies, and Nora also has been really good in terms of trying to explicate some of these thoughts as well. So instead, I'm just going to do a really short sort of a follow-up summary based on this idea of soft montage as a work of assemblage of these juxtapositions and conjunctions as well. So seed, image, ground is also an assembly in this particular sense that builds on historical archives, but also builds on contemporary images. We don't want to imply a simple causality that the images would express in what force impacts what which thing, what surface is operative, what is data. Instead, the scenes want to build a series of images that form and formulate surfaces. When we are interested in the question of the plant and the territorial surface, we approach it through image surfaces as such. When we are dealing with the image as a media surface, it leads us to ask how they're modeled, which material base and reference is apt when considering the contemporary eco-aesthetic situation. It's about energy of images in relation to growth, in relation to photosynthesis. And this could be related to a lot of contemporary work that basically refers to information architectures. Information architectures as employing the centrality of images in contemporary smart cities and smart urbanism. But we're sort of interested in what this implies also beyond cities. Hence that sort of a really brief sentence at towards the end of the video. If you haven't seen it yet, you'll see it soon, about platform ruralism. That we sort of want to look at built environments of rurality, of these non-urban sites. Seed Image Ground, as well as our research, is basically about these built environments, such as those in aerial reforestation, landscape restoration, agriculture. And here, every vegetal surface starts to function as a kind of an image, and every landscape starts to promise to behave like a networked screen as well. So there's a lot of there in terms of implications that we wanted to build through. But when you look at the video, and you'll see it after the talk, you can sort of see it also instead of the narrative sequences that are seed bombing, you can see it about sequences of surfaces. And there's a couple of sort of a giveaways of what kind of surfaces are implied there as well. Territorial surfaces and plant surfaces and agricultural surfaces, but also then surveys and landscapes and data surfaces as well. And all of this comes back to what I mentioned at the beginning through that really short snippet that referred to Celia Lurie about problem spaces. These are problem spaces, and as such, these surfaces compose each other. The sequences and actions of images form a topology of the problem at hand. Basically, it becomes a question of what is a surface, how is seed bombing a surface operation, and how do images feature in this rethinking of the territory, both from above, but also across the surfaces as data, as data platforms. So the idea about the methodological argument of a surface problem space becomes one reference point for our work, while this composition of images, quite concrete composition of images and composition of discursive concepts, are part of this work of soft montage. I want to finish it here. Hopefully there's some elements for our talk, which basically perhaps we'll follow up both on these questions of vegetal surfaces, but also perhaps I'm happy to try to link it to broader questions that relate to operational images, but also perhaps if somebody is interested in media archaeology. But that's pretty much all I want to say here. So over to you, Robert.
Thank you, Jussi. Thank you for this lecture. Yes, I wanted to begin with a simple question. Why have you concentrated on vegetal images? But I think you already pointed some things out. So I will start with another, perhaps more future-oriented question. Sure. Because the vegetal images and imaging of growth are also practices of terraforming. So in the sense of Benjamin Breton's concept and theory, and geotechnological planning with a much appreciated focus on the rural environment. So are there any broader implications and applications of your project in the context of future terraforming and geotechnological planning?
Mm-hmm. It's great. And also, there's a nice twist here. Your question is about the future of terraforming. While with Abelardo, we sort of have in our very informal chats, we've been talking about whether this is a project that is, quote, unquote, media archaeology of terraforming, a sort of a history of terraforming, in the sense that it builds this argument about terraforming as a particular surface level operation that has to do with a lot of colonial operations in relation to particular forms of planting and replanting that some environmental historians have argued is can be described as this very literal creation of Neo-Europes, 300-400 years ago, that was dependent on infrastructure of ships and shipping of seeds, but also transporting cattle into other parts of the world, and sort of concrete reformatting of environments, ecologies, according to the European quote unquote model. And that would be the sort of like backstory of something that I also have in other contexts I've called a natural history of logistics that has to do with these logistical operations that implement natural history, but also logistics in relation to particular natural formations in other ways as well. So what we sort of want to do with this is outline the historical sense of these practices that seem to be so mundane that they often, I wouldn't say that they are often ignored, because there's a lot of specialist knowledge across different fields, including social science and environmental humanities about these. So it's not to ignore the colleagues' work as well, but they've been emphasized less in media theory that has been focused on, broadly speaking, questions of urbanism much more than on ruralism. And wanting to bring this into view for a particular question of media mediation. Now, this kind of then starts to imply the question of what is the link between to this futurity of terraforming, or future-oriented sense of terraforming as well. And I would say that, broadly speaking, it resonates with this expanded emphasis of what is design that I briefly mentioned. It was such a brief mention that it might have escaped people, but Keller Easterling's medium design is a great way of sort of articulating a particular understanding of questions of design, also central to the terraforming program at Strelka in Moscow, but also beyond it. Design in relation to environmental or the active processes, not as some kind of a superimposed plan, but as an understanding of how do we frame existing earth processes, chemical processes of other in relation to design as a particular tapping into material dynamics. The other one would be that it's got a link to this expanded urbanism through questions of infrastructure that move beyond the city as a city to the infrastructures that are conditioning cities. And as such, the sort of interest that we're going to look at, and we started to look at in terms of contemporary technologies of agriculture, for instance, are central perhaps to what you were after as well. So Abelardo has done a bit more work on precision farming and so-called smart farming, but it's sort of a part of this bundle of questions of data environments of agriculture, for instance. So there's an interest in terms of looking at of the question of what are the visual media, and I'm using this slightly hesitantly because we're constantly questioning the centrality of visuality, but I'll use it as a shorthand here. What is the sort of a like transformation of visual media and the futurity of future of visual media that is not merely operating on the visual spectra? What is that in relation to interfaces with questions of concrete material transformation? In other words, questions of remote sensing, different kinds of spectral imaging, different kinds of other sorts of, let's say, non-lenticular forms of imaging that have to do with technologies, autonomous technologies, whether it's autonomous vehicles or other forms of sensing. What is this form of sensing and the sensorial that we are mapping that is interesting from the point of view of this expanded sensoria, but also that it's clearly linked to these projects that have a very concrete sense of, or concrete end aim to reformat territories, and this is not, and this is sort of a like as part of whether it's and this is not what we're going to do, but I'll give you an example. Questions of, for instance, oceanographic visual media that have to do with seafloor imaging practices, whether it's for practices of environmental management of seafloors or for the extractionist industries, or beyond, you know, beyond ocean floors, on terrestrial, surfaces, the same in relation to questions of extraction as well in terms of remote sensing and other technologies. So you see that there's a sort of a like this, the feedback loop that we are after that has to do with imaging or visual technologies that are not merely visual anymore as forms of terraforming in their own right. And I could go on, because this is really something that we've also with, you mentioned Benjamin Bratton. So Benjamin's the director for the Strelka program on terraforming. And I've been teaching on it for a couple of years. And last year we did a brief together with Abelardo, especially on the question of surfaces. So we tried to kind of build a sense of media theoretical tools, but also these sorts of, let's say, image, and I'm using tool in a very broad sense here, image tools or image ways of, image-centered ways of understanding terraforming as well as part of the education program at Strelka. But this is sort of a, like, this is a glimpse of perhaps some of the links to the notion of terraforming here as well. And it doesn't mean that we're sort of a replicating one-to-one Benjamin's program at all. It's more like we're riffing with similar themes, and we are interested in similar themes about synthetic landscapes, about planetarity, that is not merely about planetarity on the scale of a planet, but the ways in which particular technologies have planetary implications, and questions of terrestrial surfaces that are not merely about land, but about other forms of, let's say, elemental media and mediations as well. Hopefully that makes sense in terms of a response.
Yes, yes. In recent years, you developed the so-called geology of media, as a book with the same name, dealing with material and geophysical composition of digital technology, so, and also the question of waste, decomposition, disuse, and so on. You were talking a lot about the underground, so the mining, and also the satellites and so on, and now you're focusing on the surfaces. So is there a connection between, you know, the underground and the surfaces in this sense of vegetal images? Because you mentioned the chemical processes, energy and matter, and also perhaps to add, in your book Geology of Media, you also kind of articulate geology of media in relation to, you know, geopolitics, flavor, and so on. Is there a connection with vegetal images as well?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I like the very concrete description you gave, because it's exactly the sort of a, like, let's say, the concreteness of the spatial conceptualization and the ways in which it moves beyond the concreteness into the necessary abstractions that define geopolitical questions. In other words, geology of media was really literally about a book that went goes underground in terms of mines and mining, and picks up on certain, you know, historians and other works of the underground as a particular central spatial affordance for contemporary infrastructure, right? So think about cities and undergrounds, think about mines and mining. And it had that sort of a concrete relation to what we would often call extractionism and extraction industries. And there are the same things in terms of verticality upwards as well. And yet at the same time, there was also a book that was dealing with these large-scale abstractions that are central to understanding the concreteness of extraction. And I think that Sean Cupid and others have said it much better as well, that, you know, it's we could think of that book basically interested in questions of mediation of what happens from questions of concrete undergrounds of minerals and other sorts of practices as a condition of media technological modernity to questions of abstraction that is inaugurated by way of finance, for instance, metal markets, for instance, as part of this sort of a sphere of planetarity in many ways. And then it seems that this complete juxtaposition exactly in terms of a spatial conceptualization or spatial metaphorics as well. But a lot of the things that we do with Abelardo here as well is exactly of investigating surfaces, not merely as flat surfaces, but as interfaces to multiple kinds of regimes. So in other words, very concretely, many remote sensing technologies work in different spectra of radiation because ability to see beyond certain kinds of surface formations. So for instance, particular kinds of mappings of, let's say, mineral deposits or other forms of land cover formations. So there's something of an interesting concrete paradox going on in terms of surface becoming, and this is sort of echoing Gilles Deleuze's philosophical thing that surface itself is the deepest of all the elements because it spreads in so many ways and it becomes itself, and it's often metaphorized in terms of planetary skin and whatnot, but it becomes this interface for intervention and management beyond the surface as well, but it's still central as an element that has depth in its own right as well, and it's got much more to it. And the reason why we pick up on the surface is beyond the fact that we're sort of picking up on elements from my geology of media, including the concept of media natures. We're also picking up on other people's work. One to mention would be Giuliana Bruno, the cinema and media theorist, who's worked extensively on architectural surfaces as image surfaces and projection surfaces, as part of almost like textured surfaces. So there is sort of a like a interest that I'm sort of pursuing constantly as well about this question of the surface in multiple ways that would bundle up these questions of what is a texture, what is a pattern on a surface, what does patterning of a surface mean from the point of view of pattern recognition. And this sort of a like question becomes a reorganizing the question of the image in different ways. And again, to point out the obvious, the image, I mean, and it's a very sort of, it sounds generic term, but images are much more central to this work than they were to geology of media. Geology of media was a book that basically tried to map a certain material link between a certain temporal regime of deep time of media history with a particular material regime of mines and mining and waste and ecological questions, whereas surface question here is trying to link the question of what is a material surface in relation to information patterning as well. So you see that the questions of materiality and concreteness and abstraction go hand in hand all the time. And besides these philosophical themes, it's really centrally about environmental management. And John May, the architecture theorist, has a wonderful term, the managerial surface, that refers to particular digital technologies of whether we find them in landscape design or whether we find them in architectural design or whether we find them in different survey techniques. This managerial surface becomes an interesting sort of counterpoint to the aesthetic surface as well. And it's the age of managerial surfaces that is really the age of environmental management as well, that we're sort of trying to map in our work. That's the sort of a like a slightly, that's one answer to what you said, and we can sort of pick up on it later as well.
Yeah, and I think you already answered the question from Igor Strohmeier.
Yeah, but let's say hi to Igor anyway.
Yeah, what is behind the surface? Okay, so
yeah
already answered that.
Yeah, we just did. That was sort of a psychic moment with Igor we had there. That's great. And in a way, I could kind of do it much better as well, because there's something about the ways in which that the surface becomes paradoxically exactly the entry point to depths as well, in terms of like, for instance, again, I think that the example of remote sensing that is able to pick up on spectra that would be beyond visible light in order to produce mineral deposit maps. That would be a great one. Again, I did a recently a talk, sorry, discussion in the an event on extraction and media, and I already there mentioned a couple of times and mentioned again Götze and Al's work on operational images as part of remote sensing regimes. So this is really one concrete way of looking at it, but we could separately continue on the philosophical implications. But yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you about this difference between analog and digital vegetal images, and actually the once again the future of these images, mm-hmm. operational images in the form of automatization of vision, of machinic vision, of you know, the question of image in the form of data and remote sensing and so on. Mm-hmm. Is this also part of your some other part of your project with Abelardo and your book, mm-hmm. or how do you will you engage with this question? Maybe.
Yeah, absolutely.
To this.
Yeah, it's basically like this: that a lot of the sort of examples that I've been mentioning now as well could be easily bundled under questions of contemporary digital imaging, and there's a great discourse both in aesthetics and media theory and beyond that. Joanna Zielinska's non-human photography would be one great of trying to understand what does this mean for the sense of the visual when we're dealing with particular kinds of digital images that are not merely catered for the visual eye, I mean the human eye, and the particular affordances that come with remote sensing, but also data platforms as particular, not just not obviously imaging, but as sites of compilation of data sets that have a significant value for epistemic purposes, especially when compiled in relation to machine learning and as training sets for particular models, modeling practices. All of this would sort of imply the centrality of digital. But I think what we are sort of after as well to make, even if as if this wasn't already difficult enough of a task, but I'm interested in the operational images book that I finished, but also with Abelardo, we're interested in looking at, weirdly enough, data practices of images beyond digital. And this includes of looking at practices of enumeration and numbering, statistics and statistical inference in certain kinds of vegetal image practices. We did recently a paper for an academic conference on this sort of an early 20th century ecological practice in Midwest US on mapping and quantitative mapping of areas of vegetation and how it already implied a particular kind of a statistical mapping based on photographic and other framing methods as well. So the short answer is that there would be a history, and there is a history, and again, historians of data and critical, you know, many people know this, but there is a history of questions of data in already so-called analog image practices like photography as well. And looking at these intersections is really interesting because it sort of looks at beyond analog digital as such and looks at questions of numbers and statistics and enumeration as central to this regime that we are after. So that's sort of a bit, you know, quick mention of 200 years of vegetal media also refers to these practices of scientific, sometimes statistical, not always, and other forms of mapping vegetal images as numbers, right? Again, this sounds a bit generic, but when I mentioned that some of this relates to laboratory practices in plant physiology, some of it relates to this sort of a weird agricultural ecology and other practices in Midwest US, then it starts to become concrete. And it also points to the fact that we're sort of a, besides that we'll obviously, we're not silly. We, of course, pay attention to very different affordances of imaging and sensorial techniques across analog and digital. We're still interested in what was I about to say? This sort of a like other way of organizing a history of imaging that has to do with scale. So scale in quite concrete terms of that we literally move from questions of modeling or particular cellular sort of processes through history of science to plant physiology and the leaf surface to Vladimir Vernadsky and these sort of conceptualizing the planetary surface as one living tissue that has to do with that has a relation to solar energy and so forth as well.
Can you relate this to the question of temporality? You know, you mentioned deep time, so geology of the Earth, but also statistical inference is kind of a interference of a prediction, and the question of time and temporality is here very important. Yeah. So can you relate these things?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a question that is sort of dear to my heart in many ways as well. You mentioned it quite rightly. So Geology of Media was basically a book that, despite the fact that it's supposed to be about geology, is actually a book about time and temporality and at what time scale we can talk meaningfully about media and mediation and in which terms. And in this case, some similar themes pop up as well, partly by reorganizing questions that would be usually about photography or media history in relation to timeline that is actually about plant and vegetal research, so but these intersect. That's why we talk about the 200 years of vegetal images. But there's also the question that becomes more central for in relation to contemporary data platforms, in other words, machine learning and others as forms of as we mentioned, as you mentioned already as well, predictions as well. So this is one format for that, what you asked earlier as well, for the future, but also futurity of terraforming as a particular kind of a constellation of data about change, right? Whether it's satellite data, whether it's other forms of sensorial data from environmental sources, that becomes central for training particular kinds of models, whether these are for scientific purposes, commercial purposes, or other forms as well. And in a different context, but quite relevantly here as well, I sort of refer to this as the question of thousands continuous, persistently, thousands continuous and constantly recreated tiny futures. Thousands of tiny futures that are constantly replacing what we used to call futurism as one grand narrative, but constantly calculated futures that are done, whether they're done for, you know, insurance purposes, whether they're done for climate modeling, whether they're done for military purposes. So this regime of prediction industries is essential to this form of temporality. And I'm going to do a really sneaky thing here now that because everybody who's listening, Robert and I, we had a sort of a pre-chat, and I know that because you mentioned Wolfgang Ernst as an earlier guest, I want to pick up on what you said.
Yes. This will be my next question.
Do you want to pose it anyway? Because we sort of had this pre-chat, so it came to my mind, but let's jump into Ernst.
Yeah, I just wanted to, because Wolfgang Ernst was one of our previous guests of Digital Dish. And his work is focused on sound, microtemporalities, you know, machines, hardware, and so on, while yours is on vision now and more large scale things, macrotemporalities, media nature, and so on. So I wanted to ask you, is there this, but there's your common ground, media archaeology, and you're both practicing some particular version of media archaeology. So I wanted to ask, is this difference between you and Ernst imminent to the media question, so sound on the one hand and vision images on the other, or just different approach? And perhaps you can talk a little bit about your development, you know, from media archaeologists working with viruses, digital contagions, to geology of media and now operational images of this.
Yeah, it's a super interesting question. I'll try to answer it in two ways. The first one is very specific to what probably Wolfgang was talking about, what you mentioned as well, that Wolfgang is really interested in question of microtemporality, which often can be read across particular algorithmic or contemporary computational regimes. So it's very specifically really reading into this micro scale of media archaeology. And whereas I'm sort of interested in this is sort of a like, which metaphorically would sound more like Zbigniew Zielinski's deep time, but it's very concretely tied to ecological time spans. But the interesting thing is that what I just mentioned about prediction and the thousands of millions of tiny futures that are constantly being created as possible futures, as part of possible prediction models, as possible through, you know, training sets and whatnot, is an actually way of interfacing the two as well. A lot of the ways in which we understand deep time is actually interfaced through microtemporalities of computational events. So the forms of epistemology that Wolfgang is after are somewhere in the middle of the questions that I'm interested in as well, that they are the necessary epistemic infrastructure for multiple kinds of claims, whether those claims are about environment, about climate futures, or other things as well. So there is a link between that, even if otherwise our projects are slightly different. And also, Wolfgang is much more, and this is the second part of my answer, Wolfgang is much more, and it's much more invested in developing his brand of media archaeology, whereas I could go almost as far as say as media archaeology is just one part of the work that I've been doing in terms of what I was writing and have been writing as well. And it was central to a lot of things that I was interested in, also in terms of alternative media histories, like my, you know, early book on computer viruses. That's probably around the time, by the way, Igor was popping up. We met with Igor as well ages ago. That's when I was working on viruses and network culture. So that was for me a way of articulating a very different kind of media archaeology of you know, history of network culture through its accidents, right? But now I wouldn't even place a lot of my work under the broad rubric of media archaeology. It's more somewhere in the context of environmental humanities, critical data studies, and media theory, broadly speaking, as well, which is something that I kind of don't usually spend too much time thinking about, whether I'm doing this or that. But it occurred to me the other day as well, because of the new job that I'm starting in Aarhus as well, that despite the fact that I often this work of mine is read through media archaeology or read through media studies, it's been only a very temporary attachment to media studies, even if it's still very dear to my heart in certain ways. But I was trained in cultural history and history department. I worked in media studies on a couple of occasions and taught media studies, but then I've also been in an art and design school, so not just media studies. I taught cinema in a cinema department as well, and my Aarhus job is going to be in a department of digital design and information studies. So it's actually that the broader field of people invested in questions that we often talk about as media, well, it's broader than just media studies, which is really interesting because it has implications for methods as well. And some of the methods that we are employing here are sort of a mix of history of science, obviously media theory, and I mentioned media archaeology a couple of times, but it also becomes something else. And hence this, and well, I didn't even mention my affiliation in Prague is at FAMU, at the photography department. So you see that this sort of bundle of interest, that there's something interesting. And I think that most of us feel like this as well, that we don't feel that we're just in one particular department. There's a lot of interest that map across. And I think operational images is interesting because of that reason. And it's one of the lines I use in the book, that operational images is interesting because it seems to be a concept that ties together people from artistic practice and video art to film and film studies and film and cinema studies to media studies, architecture and landscape architecture to an extent. So it's something there that is the concepts are really bundles that move beyond disciplines in ways that is healthy, I think.
Okay, so once again, if you have any questions, please write them down and I will pass them to Jussi. I have perhaps one or two questions more, and then we will slowly finish and watch the rest of the video. So to go in another direction, can you provide us with some other examples of operational images? We already talked about machine vision, but the more concrete example would be facial recognition, which is, let's say, in the mainstream addressed primarily as a mode of control. So what would be your take on the subject of facial recognition, for example?
Mm-hmm. I probably don't have so many things to add that are beyond what people already been said, the ones who are really researching it as well. I'm interested in from the point of view of just when I was about to say I'm not a media archaeologist, I'm going to use the word media archaeology of face and faciality. So for me, the sort of interesting things are twofold. On the one hand, what is a media archaeology of face and faciality as a particular technique of identification? And there's very smart people who worked on this in relation to regimes of nation state and passports and other forms. And of course, Alan Sekula early on as well, in terms of the facial shot in relation to the archival subject. So the kind of a history of the mapping of the face as an information surface again goes beyond digital forms of mapping and modeling that can be implemented in machine vision systems. So again, data as something that is central to regimes of visuality beyond the digital. So that's one take. Then the contemporary version is exactly in relation to perhaps the question, again, I'm again sort of riffing on many others' work here, that it's an interesting question of interesting case of an operational image, because it's already something else than just an image as well. It involves particular forms of training sets, in particular forms of, this from Kate Crawford and Trevor Paglen's work and many others' work, particular forms of modeling practices and implemented into surveillance and whatnot. But it's already thus says that the question of the image is somewhere else than on what is being seen. And this something else is interesting me. And there's one chapter in the new book that is on this non-visuality or invisuality of the image as well. Invisual is a term that Anna Munster and Adrian McKenzie use for their take on what they call platform seeing and platform observation. And this is why I'm constantly interested in this sort of a like, if the question of visuality or visual technologies doesn't happen in the register of the visual anymore, where does it happen? Hence, many AI and data researchers say that it happens on the question of the data set, it happens on the question of the modeling practice or modeling for particular applications. It happens on the level of platforms as particular business models, but also particular forms of sort of integration of sensorial data with different processing mechanisms and different forms of turning it into property, for instance. So it's these hybrid bundles where I'm sort of trying to track images happening, and operational image thus becomes really about operations beyond the image as such as well. And that's one short answer to a really interesting and tricky question as well. And I kind of find that a lot of the really there's the work that needs to be done, because it's so important for contemporary forms of policy that is crucial for questions of justice, social justice, and racialized violence and whatnot that's been demonstrated. But then there's the question that is also like that beyond this urgency of the policy, we need to be able to look at what else is implied in the question of the face and facial recognition systems. Hence, hat tip to former PhD student of mine, Yiit Sonchul, whose PhD was before COVID, did what it did. It finished his PhD on masks and masking, as a central element of biopolitics. So the question of the mask and its relation as a, you know, in the face is here sort of another trajectory that opens up the question of facial recognition beyond the obvious answers as well.
Great, you mentioned coronavirus. So my last question is about, corona pandemics. You were dealing extensively with computer viruses and so on in your previous work. So in one of your recent articles, co-authored with Tony Sampson, you shed the light on the corona pandemics in the terms of operational images, operational loops, data visualization, and so on. Can you perhaps talk a little bit on this subject as well?
Yeah. And also to, I mean, people can find it in the Cultural Politics Journal, but that paper was basically a short entry point to really complex topics. And also I acknowledge that while we're still living in the midst of all of this crap, we don't want to hear more about COVID. But this was an attempt to sort of map its relation to the other kinds of images that we have circulating about COVID, not the sort of like a spiky blob image that became one visualization that keeps on popping up every now and then, but the sort of a really like the gray administrative images that are central to governance of it as well. So again, to state the obvious, because we've been seeing too much of this already, but different forms of diagrams, different forms of graphs, different forms of curves, and forms of part of the lineage of statistical imaging and statistical graphics as well. So the question is that, you know, in the history of statistical graphs and diagrams, how do we sort of mobilize this in relation to the contemporary forms of governance of this phenomenon as well? Hence the idea about the loops here as well, that the loop is part of the question of production of certain kinds of images with a particular epistemic value, whether it's true or not, because there's a constant political use of particular images as well. But also that that there's a sort of a connection between the aesthetic and epistemic that we're interested in as well. We'll post the link as well. Soon, give me a second. But it's basically around this topic as well. Not what is observation and perception that is meaningful in this context is after. Oh yeah, and what I wanted to mention is this as well, that it has a couple of examples of these speculative diagrams by David Benguer diagrams. So it's a kind of a nice nod towards the fact that there's a anyone, and there might be visual designers. I mean,
and also history of visualization, data visualization in some previous epidemics and so on. I think that's also interesting in today's situation.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, so I think our time is up. So, Jussi, thank you very much for your lecture and your time to talk with me, to talk with us. It was a pleasure.
Thank you. It's really is a pleasure.
It was a pleasure to have you here. I hope we will meet someday in person and or another occasion. Or
I hope that too.
That you will Thanks come so in Ljubljana in some, I hope, near future.
yeah, that's so, my wish.
So thank you again. And now we will stream the video seat image ground in entirety. So thank you and bye.
Thank you.
Director Andrei Tarkovsky's fondness of nature led to the practical question: how do you fabricate wind for cinema? How does wind become an image? Tarkovsky relied on motorized aerial power. The gusts were created by a helicopter well placed for this artificial effect that blows across the crop field. Around the same period, countless aerial operations redesigned landscapes, cities, and fields. Mostly these were military operations. Some were agricultural. In some cases, the two were and remain indistinguishable. Fabricating wind is close to what cinema does anyway, creating movement across vast surfaces. Airborne, the surface is a field of operations. Surveying, bombing, hydrating, seeding, replanting, calculating, quantifying. The military history of the aerial view transforms also into guerrilla farming. What is perceived as planetary surface is transformed into synthetic surfaces with chemistry, captured as synthetic landscapes, as data. Logistics of perception is also logistics of synthesis. Many of the images in this video are from companies promoting their seed bombing services. Some are more speculative. The persistence of military metaphors is obvious, yet peculiar. Isn't there a discrepancy between the rapidity of destruction and the slowness of growth? Seed pods hit the ground. They replant and restore vegetal surfaces. We are shown airplanes and drones. They are better for accessing difficult sites, we are told. They can cover much larger areas than by foot. The scenes we have combined, juxtaposed, and rearranged show the air, the ground, seeds, and images. They show the air from the ground from the air, the plants as images, and images as they define the ground. A circulation of how we know and how we picture, how images grow, and how growth is imaged. Most of what we see deals with pace and speed, how to hasten the transformation of living surfaces. Surfaces are managed vertically as part of a longer history of the motorized descent. First as war, then as reforesting. First as images, then as bombing. First as aerial photography, then as automated drone surveys. It feels like surfaces are lifted off the ground. We shift between the lab and the landscape. What happens in a lab is repeated in a landscape. Those are remade into laboratories too. Plants fabricate landscapes. They take shape, change color, redefine areas on soil level and in remote sensing. The growth is analyzed as images. This transformation is accelerated through chemistry. The time lapse is one form of picturing the artifice of nature. Images are laboratory instruments. Also, images travel from the lab to the landscape. Territories and growth are measured as time and location. Techniques of speed and acceleration are not only for war. Low-tech seed bombing gives way to automation of airspace. Airspace to landscape. Imaging in order to operate. Operate in order to transform. Territorial grids are replaced with precision markers for drone navigation. The surface is analyzed as data that abstracts the biosphere into a circulation of images. Environmental management is a recursive loop. Analysis of surface as images, images as data, seeding and monitoring according to data, and repeat. Seeding is one form of image making. It transforms the soil into a perception of light. The scenes you are watching feature images of images, or perhaps images within images, or even images imprinted onto landscapes. Images that can be grown, and images that emerge as data from that growth. The continuum of the color code, operations of green surfaces, and operations of colorful data visualizations. Could we name this as platform ruralism? Images grown by forests as models for technical systems. Digital images are for planning and management. Screens on top of soil, but also images that emerge from the soil, sensing on and off the ground. They redefine the thin living surface as intellectual property control and as intellectual capital management. A territorial surface brought into the value systems of digital platforms. Thank you.